Welcome to Twickenham. Glad you're here. So thankful that you all made it safely through the ice and snow. We are actually giving away this morning tire chains so that you can safely transit throughout Huntsville. And if you're a Huntsville native and you feel like I'm making fun of you, I'm from Atlanta, the town where we get an eighth of an inch of ice and people are stranded on the interstate for days. So it's okay. And if you're from the north, and you're making fun of us, you don't know how to drive in pollen, okay? And we do, so. Hey, we're glad you're here. If you are looking for a church home, we don't care where you're from. We are always looking to add new family members and would love to talk with you about how we do that. There is a card on the back of the seat in front of you. You can fill that out and place that in the collection plate a little bit later on. If you have a prayer request, indicate that on the card, and we will be praying about that as early as tomorrow. We're just really glad you're here. Thanks for coming. Let's take a moment. Let's stand and greet each other with a hug and a handshake, and then we'll get on with our time of praise. Glad you're here.
Trust in the name of the Lord, are we trust? in the name of the Lord our God,
the God of the heavens,
the
Ancient of Days,
the God of our fathers,
and God of our praise,
the Alpha Omega.
To him with his disciples, he said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul?"
Let's take our offering.
Praise unbroken, praise unending, be yours forevermore. Praise untainted, praise unfading, be yours forevermore. Be yours. Be yours,
So let my deeds outrun my words, and let my life outweigh my songs. So let my deeds outrun my words, and let my life outweigh my songs. So let my deeds outrun my words, and let my life outweigh my songs. Unbroken praise be yours, God, forever. All my praise be yours, God, forever. Lord, take this life, let it become your throne. Unbroken praise be yours. So let my deeds outrun my words, and let my life outweigh my songs. Unbroken praise be yours. My heart, my mind, my body, my soul, I give to you. Take control. I give my body a living sacrifice. Lord, take control. Take control. My heart, my mind, my body, my soul, I give to you. Take control. I give my body a living sacrifice. Lord, take control.
For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that's to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. And not only the creation, but we ourselves wait eagerly for the revealing, the redemption of our bodies. If you don't follow Jody, I hope you will. If you do follow Jody, you've likely already read his post from yesterday, a post that dealt with the fact that collectively and certainly individually, we as a congregation are in a season of great loss. We have seen the passing of six dear friends, beloved family members, and people whom our hearts hold dear. And yet we hold on to hope because Romans 8 tells us we can. Because of what is written in Romans 8, we know that when our great grandparents sinned in Genesis 3, it fractured not only the relationship with God and each other, but it broke the cosmos. And when it broke the cosmos, it changed everything. And because of that, our bodies grow old and tired, and they wear out. Sin ravages us. The fog of dementia rolls in, and takes precious memories from us. But in the midst of all of that, there is hope. Because when the creation was subjected to futility, it was not simply subjected to futility, but it was subjected in hope. And because of that hope, the entire cosmos, all the billions upon billions of stars, wait eagerly for our redemption. And we groan with the cosmos as we wait for that redemption. Because what Romans 8 tells us is that in the midst of our suffering, there is coming a time when the God who spoke those billions and billions of stars into existence, the God whose mighty hand has shaped every moment in history, that God, in tender mercy, will kneel down, and with his mighty hand, he will wipe the last tear from our eyes. And our bodies will be restored. No more will sin invade our life with its pain and its suffering. It is true that now, sorrow and death and all the heartbreak of sin dog us, and it is all around us. We feel the weight of it. But it is also true that they are little more than yapping chihuahuas, because we serve a God who is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And that Lion is mighty to save. And he not only is mighty to save, but he enters into our suffering. It was that God who left the comforts of heaven and came to walk this earth and be cold at night. It was that God who joined us in our poverty as he left the splendors of the throne room of God to walk this world without so much as a house to call his own. It was that God who suffered the pain of betrayal as one of his own would turn him over to his enemies. And as we collectively and you personally mourn the death of those you love, it was that God who mourned the death of his very Son to make us one with him. Mourning so great that it shook the very earth and blotted out the sun. It's that God who is good enough to call us to take a little piece of cracker and a thimble of grape juice every week, so that when the sorrow of sin and all its pain overtakes us, and all that it has bought overwhelms us, we might remember that we have a hope, and that hope's name is Jesus. Let's pray. Father, you are good to consider us. You are good to join in our suffering and our pain. You are good to be the Emmanuel, God who walks among his people. And as we take of this bread, we do so, Father, needing you so desperately, needing your presence, needing that gentle assurance that in the midst of our heartbreak and suffering, you are near, you are our hope, and that you are a God who is so desperately for us, so passionately in our corner, that you would suffer and die as one of us to make us one with you. And for that, Lord, we praise and we thank your name. In Christ's name we pray it. Amen.
Here I am, O God, I bring this sacrifice, my open heart. I offer up my life, I look to you, Lord, your love that never ends, restores me again. So I lift my eyes to you, Lord, in your strength will I break through, Lord, touch me now, let your love fall down on me, and I will be complete in you.
Father, how lavish is your love for us, that by the blood of your Son, you have made us sons and daughters, so that in the midst of these lives that we live, such a weird mixture of joy and heartbreak, that we might know and that we might live under the pervasive reality that the King of the universe has made us his own. And if he is for us, who can be against us? For this, Father, for this great blessing among blessings, we thank you in the name of your Son. Amen.
Here I am, O God, I bring this sacrifice, my open heart. I offer up my life, I look to you, Lord, your love that never ends, restores me again. So I faith I will
Genesis chapter 11, if you want to go over there, first book of the Bible. Hey, tonight's the spring. Are we up here or downstairs?
Downstairs?
We are downstairs at 5 o'clock. I knew that. I got it. 5 o'clock tonight in the spring, our instrumental service, we will have snakes. I'm not kidding. We will have snakes. Are we still doing that? Yeah, okay, that's what I thought. So, the rumors you've heard about Twickenham are true, I guess. So. All right. Hey, I want you to take a look at some words here. We get these on the screen. Can we get my words on the screen? There we go. No, not those words. We did those words. Let's do some different words. So, oh, here we go. Here they are. That's, oh, okay, good. Okay, take a look at those words. Unprecedented, revolutionary, innovative, seminal, new, next gen, novel, advanced, transformational, leading edge. Kind of what, when you look at those words, Sort of what images or ideas do those evoke in your mind? You probably see those a lot at work, right? And you look at those and you think, you know, he's going to talk to us about some new technology and how it's impacting our lives and interfering with our faith. Like maybe he found out that we are actually reverse engineering alien spaceship technology over in the arsenal, or somewhere in Research Park we're this close to figuring out how to get through the DNA of some alien we captured and we're going to create an alien human hybrid and take over the world. And now we're going to have to disappear our preacher because somebody talked. I know what you do on the arsenal. I mean, I think I know. I know that Area 51 is a government, nothing's there. It's all here in Huntsville. Because some of the aliens go to church here. That's my sense. Actually, those words in this context don't have anything to do with anything that's going on in Research Park or on the arsenal or anywhere in Huntsville, or not even anything that's going on in 2017. They describe an event and a group of people from the very first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 11. It's a story that took place thousands of years ago, and yet those words fit what happened there. What happened there was unprecedented in many ways. And what we'll find out is that it is, even though it's thousands of years old, it's as fresh as tomorrow morning's headlines. We'll get to that in just a minute. We're starting a new series this morning called Journeys, When God Says Go. From the very beginning of time, God has called his people to step out of their comfortable surroundings and to take a journey. It's very tempting for you, for me, to stay with what we know, to stay with what is safe, to stay with what is convenient. It's always risky to go, to do something different. But if we want to be blessed, if we want to be a blessing, then we've got to be willing to risk the journey. And so for the next several weeks, we're just going to be confronted by God's call to go, to get out of our routines and to risk doing something different with our lives. Now, let me just add something here anytime the preacher starts talking about change and risk and doing something different, there's always somebody in the church goes, oh my, what are they going to spring on us? What are they about to spring on us? If we're about to spring something on you other than the snakes tonight, I don't know what it is. I don't know if any conversations like that are going on. We're not talking about doing something different in terms of how we worship. We're talking about doing something different in terms of how we live in our neighborhoods and in our schools and in our jobs. We're talking about getting out of what's comfortable and convenient and doing something different there. Genesis 11 is a great place to start because it tells the story of this group of people who were on the move but decided to stop. They decided to settle in a place called Shinar. It means the land of two rivers, which probably explains why they wanted to settle there. So here's what I want to do. I want to read the first four verses of Genesis chapter 11 because that describes what the people did. And we'll talk about that for a minute. And then we'll pick up and read the last four verses of the passage we're going to look at, 5-9, because that describes God's response to it. Because that's kind of how we'll go here. Let's look at Genesis chapter 11 beginning in verse 1. I think it'll be on the screen, but it would be good for you to look it up as well. Okay, here we go. Now, the whole world had one language and a common speech. As people moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. And they said to each other, come, let's make bricks and bake them thoroughly. They used brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. And then they said, come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens so that we may make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we will be scattered over the face of the whole earth. Okay, so the first thing that I think it's really important to note is that as the story begins, people are on the move. Verse 2 said they were moving eastward. The English Standard Version actually says they were migrating. They migrated. And the New English Translation calls it a journey. So you've got people who are moving, who are migrating, who are taking the journey, and then they stop. Now, why is it important that they're on the move when the story begins? Well, because that's precisely what God commanded them to do. A lot of folks don't know this, but in Genesis chapter 1, verse 28, God commanded Adam and Eve to be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth and subdue it. God's intent was for people to fill the earth and not live forever in the Garden of Eden. And that command is repeated twice more. In Genesis chapter 9, verse 1, God blessed Noah and his sons, and he said to them, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth. Genesis chapter 9, verse 7, he said, as for you, be fruitful and increase in number, multiply on the earth and increase upon it. So God's will from the very beginning was for people to move, to spread out, to fill every corner of the earth. And if you think about it, that sounds a little bit like what Jesus told his disciples in Matthew chapter 28, what we call the Great Commission, where Jesus said, go and make disciples of all nations. In other words, go and fill the earth with my message, increase the number of disciples on the earth. Genesis 1:28, Genesis 9:1, Genesis 9:7, that's the Great Commission of the Old Testament. So when we get to chapter 11, people are living out God's command. They're doing what God wants them to do. They are moving, they are migrating, they are on the journey, and then they stop. And they decide to settle. So they pitched their tents on the plain in Shinar, and they called a halt to the journey. And then somebody said, hey, you know what we ought to do? We should try shaping clay into rectangular prisms. Make them, just make bricks, and then bake it in fire. That way, instead of building with thatch or mud or stone, we'll have a uniform construction material. And then somebody else said, we could seal the seams with tar. That way the bricks will stick together and it'll keep the rain and cold at bay in the winter. And so they did, and it worked, and it was innovative, and it was advanced. It was a technological leap, and it beat the daylights out of living in a tent. The temptation, though, with technology is that we get so caught up in asking, can we do this thing? We never ask, should we do this thing? And that's true in Genesis chapter 11, and it's true here and now. And then somebody else said, you know what else we ought to do? We ought to build us a city, which makes perfect sense if you're them. I mean, if you're always on the move, you're always vulnerable to the elements and to enemies. But if you build a city, you gain a measure of control over your life. You gain a measure of control over nature, because if you build a city, you're no longer at the whims of the rainfall. You can store rainwater, and you can keep it for periods of drought, and you can store the food that you grow as crops, and you can keep that in during times of famine. So you get a measure of control over nature. And then if an enemy comes to attack you, you can close the gates and mount the walls and rain fury down on anybody who threatens you. So settling down and building a city satisfied one of the most basic human needs, security. They built the city because they wanted security. What happens next? When you no longer have to spend all your waking hours foraging for food or fighting off enemies or forging ahead for the next 20 miles down the road, what happens when your basic need for security is handled? You start thinking about significance. That's verse 4. Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens so that we may make a name for ourselves. They wanted security, so they built a city. And then they wanted significance, so they built a tower. People will see our architecture, they'll see our tower with its magnificence, and they will think we are awesome. When I was a kid, I always thought that they were building the tower because they were, this is how, you know, my kid mind thought, especially since I was a boy and had uncles in the military and loved war movies. I thought they were building the tower because they wanted to mount an assault on heaven. I thought what they were going to do is they're going to build a tower and they were going to invade it. That's not what they're doing. They're not thinking about heaven. They're not thinking about God. They're trying to rebuild Eden. They're trying to build a godless Eden. They're trying to create a safe space and make their mark. They're reaching for security and significance. They want risk-free living, and they want to look good doing it. You don't have to look too hard to see that we're not all that different, though, from these ancient people. We want what they wanted. We want to look good, and we want to live securely. And we do that in a lot of different ways. Some people try to build that kind of life or those kinds of lives with possessions. We amass a lot of nice stuff and surround ourselves with it. Or we do it with positions. We accumulate titles and authority. Some people even use religion. Makes us feel safe. Makes us look good. Ultimately, though, however we do it, it's all about gaining control. It's about doing what you want, how you want to do it, the way you want it done. Every person in this room, in some way or another, has said, come, let us build ourselves a city. Let me build myself a city. So what does God think of their project? That's Genesis chapter 11, beginning in verse 5. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower the people were building. And the Lord said, if as one people speaking the same language they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language so that they will not understand each other. So the Lord scattered them from there over all the earth, and they stopped building the city. That is why it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the whole world. From there the Lord scattered them over the face of the earth. So now be honest. God's response here is troubling, isn't it? I mean, doesn't God seem a little petty here? It sounds like God feels threatened by this industrious group of people. Like he's saying, have you seen what they're doing down there on the plain of Shinar? They built this city, and they're building this tower. And if they've started this, then nothing they decide to do will be impossible for them. We've got to go down there and stop them. That's what it sounds like God is saying. So let's think about that. You think God is really threatened? The God who created the universe? The God who spoke the universe and those billions of stars that Lee mentioned earlier into existence? Do you think the God who did that is intimidated by people who build a tower? Look at verse 5 again. Look at what it says. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower the people were building. You see that? The Lord came down to see the tower. It's a little Hebrew humor there. It's like God, some angel said, they're building a tower, and God goes, I don't see a tower. I'll have to go down to get closer. And so God goes down, and he goes, oh, look, that's a cute tower. Did you build that all by yourself? God's not intimidated by the tower. Here's the thing. This is the thing you should remember. What amazes humans amuses God. We get, whoa. God's like, yawn. Yeah. The second thing here is God is not opposed to human potential. God is not against human potential. God is all about human potential. Jesus once even told his disciples, the things that I've been doing, you will do. You will even do greater things than these. God loves for us to achieve and accomplish and succeed. God does not have a problem with human potential. God's got a problem with human plans. It's not that God's afraid that we're going to succeed. God's concerned about what we're going to succeed at. Back in Genesis chapter 6, there's an assessment of human potential that we don't like, but we can't deny. The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thought of the human heart was only evil all the time. That's why God was concerned about their potential. Not because they might succeed, but because of what they might do with their success. See, we know this about ourselves. We know that we're capable of enormous good. We have enormous potential for good, but we are also capable of the most despicable evil. That's why you have locks on your doors and alarm systems in your homes and access codes for your digital devices. That's why some people carry guns, and why you voted the way you did, and why you felt relieved at the outcome or terrified by it. We don't trust human plans either. God did not break up the party at Babel because he was afraid of human potential. He did not confuse their language because he felt threatened by their construction project. God frustrated their plan because it threatened their future, not his. The language confusion at Babel, in fact, was not a punishment at all. That was a rescue. And the truth is, they were settling for far less than God wanted to give them. We're in Genesis chapter 11. Look one chapter over to Genesis chapter 12. We'll be here next week. You remember what the folks on the plain of Shinar wanted, what the people in Babel wanted? They wanted security and they wanted significance. That's what they wanted. And they were trying to get a do-it-yourself security and do-it-yourself significance. Well, listen to what God promises a man named Abram. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. And you will be a blessing. You know what that is? That's significance. That's God saying, Abram, those people on the plain of Shinar tried to create their own significance. I'm going to give you significance. I'm going to make you significant. I'm going to make you so important that thousands and thousands and thousands of years later, in a country you've never even heard of, speaking a language you'll never learn, people are going to be talking about you. And here we are. I'd say Abram is pretty stinking significant. And God gave that to him. Look at the next part of this verse. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. You know what we call that? Security. If God says, somebody blesses you, I'm going to bless them. Somebody curses you, I'm going to make them an offer they can't refuse. That's security. God is giving Abram security. The very things the people on the plain of Shinar were trying to do for themselves, God promised to do for Abram. They didn't just settle in terms of putting down roots in a geographical location. They settled in the sense of accepting less than God wanted to give them, which makes me wonder if I ever do that. And do you? Let me give you a couple of questions you can ask yourself to see if you settle. Here's the first one. What's your city? What's your city? They wanted a city because it promised security. And so when we ask, what's my city? I'm asking, what is it that I look to make me feel secure? Where's my security? What makes me feel like everything is going to be okay? Is it a number on a bank account? Or in a portfolio? Do I think everything's going to be okay because of a relationship I have with another human being? The right political party being in power, is that what makes me feel secure? Look, if the thing that makes you feel secure, if the thing that makes you feel safe is not God, then you're not safe. You're not secure. What's your city? Second question, what's your tower? What's your tower? The tower for them was a symbol of success. That was their monument to their awesomeness. So when I ask, what's my tower? What I'm asking is, what is it that makes me feel significant? Is it an ability? Is it a talent? Is it an accomplishment? Is it my resume, my educational level? Is it approval from other people? Is that what makes me feel significant? It helps me to remember that the things that amaze humans amuse God. What's your tower? If your significance isn't coming from what God did for you in Jesus Christ, then you're not significant yet. And then third question, who are my people? Who are your people? Stories like this would don't just tell us about ourselves, they tell us something about God. And one of the things we learn about God in this story is that God loves, I'm going to use a word that some of you are really tired of hearing, okay? God loves diversity. Some of us are weary with that word. Some of us may feel like we've been kind of beat up with that word. Maybe it'll help you to remember that the concept of diversity is not some newfangled notion cooked up by media elites or liberal professors at an Ivy League college. It comes from the first book of the Bible. It comes from God. And since diversity is God's idea, we, if we're going to love and follow God, have to embrace it. Here's a question. Why does God love diversity? I could be wrong about this, but see if this makes sense. Okay, this is some of the weirdness out of Jody's head, but see if it makes sense. If human beings forge a unity based on their similarities, like the good citizens of Babel did, then their unity is inherently exclusionary. If you're not like them, you are not welcome to participate in their unity, regardless of how much you are willing to contribute or how much you're capable of contributing. Because instead of being inclusive, that kind of unity that's based on human similarity becomes clannish. Instead of offering hospitality, it becomes hostile. But if unity is based on something other than our intrinsic similarities, if it comes from something extrinsic, something outside of ourselves, something we can't take credit for, then it becomes inclusive, receptive, and welcoming. They say that every passage in the Bible is a road and that all the roads lead to Jesus. Let me show you something really cool. Acts chapter 2. The scene is a feast called Pentecost. People from all over the world have come to Jerusalem to celebrate. 7 weeks earlier, Jesus had told his disciples to go there and wait for what God had promised them. God was going to give them power. On the day of Pentecost, that promise came with power. The disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began these 12 Galileans who had never studied anything other than how to catch a fish and maybe a little bit of Torah, these 12 Galileans began speaking in languages they had never studied. It was the undoing of Babel. Luke says that people from every nation under heaven were staying in Jerusalem, and those people, amazed at what they were witnessing, asked, "How is it that each of us hears them in our own native language?" Peter stood up. He explained what was happening, and his explanation was Jesus. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and King. Here's why I think God loves diversity. Because it glorifies Jesus as the one and only way human community can be created and kept. God loves diversity. God loves all of the different languages and people on this planet he has created because it glorifies Jesus as the one and only way community can be created and kept.
And let me show you one more really cool thing. We started in the first book of the Bible, Genesis. We just stopped off in Acts chapter 2, the beginning of the church. Listen to Revelation chapter 5, verse 9, the last book of the Bible. And they sang a new song. You are worthy, Jesus, to take the scroll and open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. On the plain of Shinar, in a city called Babel, people settled for do-it-yourself security, do-it-yourself significance, and homemade unity. In Jesus, God offers unshakable security, ultimate significance, and an inclusive community. It is time for you and for me to stop settling for less than what God wants to give. It is time to let God be our security, to let God be our significance, and to welcome everyone God loves and welcomes, and that's everyone. We're going to have an invitation this morning. What we mean by that is that we're going to give you an opportunity to ask us for prayer. I'm going to ask our shepherds, guys, I'm calling a little bit of an audible here because I didn't mention this to you earlier, ask our shepherds and their wives just to kind of stand around the edges of the room. I'll be down front. And if you need our prayers this morning, we want to be here for you. We want, even if it's a little bit uncomfortable for you to get up and move around and come down front or go off to the side, I want to ask you to step out of your comfort zone and take that journey. May feel like, they say that the aisle at church is the longest walk you'll ever take. Take that journey and pray with us. Maybe there's something going on in your life, and it was a part of your life in 2016, and you resolved, I'm just going to deal with that. Let's pray about it. Maybe there's a struggle you're going through right now, and you haven't told anybody, or you haven't told enough people, and you need somebody to pray with you about it. Let's do that. Or maybe you've learned what Jesus wants from you. You know what it is, and you're ready to resolve to do that. Let us know. We'll pray with you about it. It could be that you're ready to give your life to Him in baptism this morning. We'll stop everything we're doing to assist you with that. Let's stand, let's sing, let's get our shepherds off to the sides, and then we'll have prayer if you need it.
My heart, my mind, my body, my soul, I give to you. Take control. I give my body a living sacrifice. Lord, take control. Take control, my heart, my mind, my body, my soul. I give to you. Take control. I give my body a living sacrifice. Lord, take control, take control.
Hey, thanks so much for being here today. Just a couple of things as we close. Again, tonight is the spring. It's at 5 o'clock. Snakes might be a little bit of an exaggeration, but there might be some snakes. Not live, but now you can come back and find out what that's all about. Secondly, Hoy Ledbetter has been put on a ventilator, and we need to keep the family in our prayers as they are going to have some tough decisions to make that he is not responding right now whatsoever. So keep them in your prayers this week. And Eric's got our closing prayer. Come on and pray us out. And we'll see you tonight at 5 o'clock. We'll have hot chocolate and coffee and refreshments since it's going to be cold. So come back and join us at 5.
Pray with me, please. Oh, sovereign God, we come to you giving you all praise, honor, and glory. We love you so much. You are our Father, and Father, we pray that you would help us to live by faith each and every day. Father, help us, as Jody said, to find our security in your Son, in you, and your glory. Find our significance, our identity in you. And Father, we know that as Isaiah says, the towers will fall on the day of judgment. And Father, we pray that our hope and our security is not in towers of this world, but in you as our strong tower. God, we pray that we would seek your kingdom and its righteousness first and foremost, God, and we pray that that all other agendas would be pushed aside, Father, for first and foremost us seeking you. God, we know there are several in our congregation grieving right now. We pray for the peace that passes understanding. Help us to mourn with those that are mourning and rejoice with those who are rejoicing. And again, help us to love our neighbors as ourselves. Be hospitable. Help us to look outside of ourselves as we seek to follow your Son Jesus, to meet every need that we come upon. God, forgive us of our sins when we do fail you, and again, create in us a clean heart and renew a right spirit. We love you so much. It's in your Son's perfect name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.